Good afternoon. Welcome to all of you for today's session. So in the last couple of classes, I think we have seen enough of vector algebra and calculus to help us ride through the course. So today we will start with the actual part of electromagnetic fields, and we'll be dealing with Coulomb's law, electric field intensity, and what's the meaning of a point charge, line charge, and volume charge. So these are some fundamental concepts which we will be taking up today. Now, I think we are all familiar in physics about the unit for charge being coulombs. Now, one coulomb is a really massive amount of charge. If you just take the charge of a single electron, and you know electron and proton have the same charge, electron is said to be negatively charged and proton is said to be positively charged. So electron charge is just 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19 coulombs. So this number should give you an idea about, you know, how large a quantity a coulomb is. So you would be finding that often we would not be using the word, we would not be using the unit coulomb, but rather would be using something like nano coulomb, which is coulomb into 10 to the power of minus 9, or micro coulombs, which is into 10 to the power of minus 6. So you will come across these units more commonly than you would a coulomb. Now, in nature, basically we have two types of charges: the positively charged particle, which is the proton, and the negatively charged particle, which is the electron. Now, don't ask me why proton is positive and electron is negative. It was just observed that there were two types of charges, and it so happened that proton was said to be positive and electron was said to be negative, and that convention stuck. Otherwise, there's no reason. Either one of them could have been called positive and negative. Now, if you look at the atomic structure, the protons are very closely bound in the nucleus. Okay, you have a very strong force which is binding them, right? And the electrons are revolving around the nucleus. So normally any charge transfer is to do with electrons rather than with protons. So if you have an atom, every atom is electrically neutral. That means there are as many electrons as the number of protons. So if you take any single atom, it has zero net charge. Now, if you want to make it positively charged, I'm not going to add some protons to it. Rather, what we would be doing is we would be removing some electrons from it. So when you start with electrons and protons are equal, so when I remove some electrons, the number of protons become more than the number of electrons, so the atom becomes positively charged. It becomes now positive. Similarly, when I want to make it negatively charged, I would be adding some electrons. So whenever you have two materials, you remember from physics, a fur rubbing against your skin, and or amber and silk, you know, rubbed against each other, there is always a transfer or a movement of electrons, not of protons. Okay, so this is how we charge particular bodies. So now to move on, Coulomb did some experiments. So this is what I told you: you have in the center, you have protons and neutrons, and you have the electrons revolving around it. Coulomb did some experiments and observed a couple of things. First, he observed that when there are like charges, okay, there is a force of repulsion. That means if you try to bring two like charges together, they will move away. Similarly, if you try to bring two unlike charges, that is a positive and a negative charge, they will tend to get attracted. So this was one observation. Okay, important. The like charges ripple, that means the force is away from each other, and unlike charges attract, which means the force is towards each other. Now you know that any force results in a movement and in an acceleration. Okay, so now coming back to what Coulomb observed, he observed that this force was proportional to the product of two charges, of the two charges under question or under consideration, and inversely proportional to r squared, where r is the distance between the two charges. Is it clear? So now first of all let us see what is a law and how is a law different from a theory or a theorem. A law is an experimental observation. Is it clear? A law is an experimental observation. You have Coulomb's law, you have Gauss's law, and you have Ohm's law, Kirchhoff's laws. We have so many laws. So they're Newton's laws of motion. These are all conclusions arrived at by observing experimentally certain relationships between parameters. Now every law can have a domain. Okay, I just now told you that Coulomb's law between like charges is repulsive. Then why don't protons just rip apart and fly from the nucleus? Because they are so close. It's inversely proportional to r squared. So r is very small. So the force is very, very large. So there Coulomb's law doesn't apply. There is some other force which applies. Okay. So Coulomb's law has some domain of application. Now what? So there is this constant of proportionality k. Now this k is, so q1 is the charge on mass 1. So you have two bodies, right? And q2 is the charge on mass 2. And r is the distance between the two charges. Then this is the force experienced. And this constant k, it's not a dimensionless quantity. It has a unit of Newton meter square per Coulomb square. So if you want to remember what k is given by 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. Okay, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. This epsilon naught is called as the permittivity of free space. Epsilon naught is the permittivity of free space. Normally in physics they use 8.854 into 10 to the power of minus 12. Okay, a simpler one would be to remember it as 1 by 36 pi into 10 to the power of minus 9. Both are the same. So this 1 by 36 pi into this would work out to be this, because this is harder to memorize, and in our equations very often this will get cancelled, so it is easier to use this. So remember, epsilon naught is 10 to the power of minus 9 by 36 pi. Okay, and k is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. So therefore now look at these two forces, q1, I have q2. Right, now both these forces, both of them experience the same force but in opposite directions. Why opposite directions? Now let's assume both q1 and q2 are similar, like charges, right? So q2 will move away, right, and q1 will move away from q2. So you see, if q1 moves in this direction, q2 will move in this direction. And therefore, Q2 will move in this direction, and therefore their directions are opposite. Okay. So now, I want to put this direction. You remember, force is a vector. It's not a scalar. So this gives me only the magnitude. Q1, Q2 by 4 pi epsilon naught r squared gives me only the magnitude. Right. But then if I want to show the direction, then the direction of this force is along the line joining the charge q1 to the charge q2, right? It is along this line. So how do I show something as along that line? I only want to show the direction is along that line. This is the magnitude, and the direction is along the line joining Q1 and Q2. So we know that the unit vector contains information on the direction. So I have A12, right? So now I write the force on F2. Okay, what is the force on F2? What is force F2? It is the force experienced by the charge Q2 because of the presence of Q1. Right? Now I have put A12. Now you can ask me, along with this, do I have to make the additional statement that like charges attract, ripple and unlike charges attract? No. It is contained in this A12. Why? You see, if both are similar, A12 direction would be like this. So automatically the direction of Q2 is oriented away from Q1. Similarly, if you want the force on Q1, it would be from 2 to 1. So from 2 towards 1, which is in this direction. So again, you see, it is away. Okay. So now supposing one of them is negative. Okay, then what will happen to A12? A12 will be in the reverse direction. So if this is negative, you see the force on Q2 would be in the minus direction. So it will be like this. So automatically you can see that the force is oriented towards Q1, which means that it is attractive. Are you getting my point? Yes. So you don't have to specifically talk about attraction and repulsion. That information is contained in this vector itself. Okay, so let me remind you, this is the force on Q2 due to the presence of Q1, and the distance between Q1 and Q2 is R12, and it's in the direction of the unit vector joining the point 1 to 2. Clear? Now this charge which I have discussed is called as a point charge. That means the charge is concentrated on at a single point. It neither has a surface nor it has a volume. It just is located at a single point, a concentrated charge at a single point. Okay, so such charges are called as point charges, right? So now let's move on. And let us look at a simple example. And see, after all, I told you everything, the whole idea of doing so much of vectors is that you know how to do the problems. So now I have a charge Q1 of 3×10⁻⁴ coulombs. So I want to draw your attention to the unit of the charge. You see, it will be very small. At M123, so what does this mean? This is at point 1, 2, 3, at a point M. And I have a charge Q2 −10⁻⁴ coulombs located at N205 in vacuum. Find the force exerted on Q2 by Q1. I already know the formula, right? Formula part is very simple. Q1 × Q2 divided by 4πε₀. Now I have to find R, the distance between 1 and 2. Right? Remember, whenever we spoke of the vector, I told you it is always the destination coordinates minus the source coordinates. Okay? So my destination is N and my source is M. So what would it be? 2−1ax. 2−1ax, and then 0−2ay, and 5−3az. Clear? So the destination point and the corresponding source point, you take the difference. So I get ax−2ay+2az. So what is this? This is the vector joining point 1 and 2, right? And the magnitude of this vector will be root of x² + y² + z², you know, the magnitude of any vector. So it is root of 1+4+4, that is root 9, which is 3. So R12 is equal to 3, And the unit vector along R1, 2, what is it? It is a vector R divided by the magnitude. So I get AX minus 2AY plus 2AZ divided by 3. So this is the unit vector. So what is my Coulomb's force? F2, this is the force on Q2 because of Q1, is equal to Q1 into Q2 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught is 10 to the power of minus 9 by 36 pi R squared into AR. So I get this. So that is equal to minus 30 into this vector into newtons. So this is the unit vector, right? So the magnitude of this force is 30 newtons. The magnitude of the force is 30 newtons. So now if you want to split it into components, just expand this vector and you get minus 10 AX plus 20 AY minus 20 AZ. Right, this is F2, and the force on F1 would be equal and opposite to the force on F2. So F1 is minus F2. So this gives the force on the charge. This is the first simplest example for Coulomb's law. Now let's do a small exercise. I have a force Q, point charge in space, right? Now I take a test charge, unit charge, that means 1 coulomb I take. So now what happens if I keep it here at this point? What is the force experienced by this unit charge? In which direction will it be? It will be along this direction, right? So now as I move the unit charge around, what can I do? I can find out what is the force experienced by this unit charge at any point in space. Clear? So now let's say this is a point charge and I move my unit charge around it in a circle. So now what happens at every point? Since I'm moving in a circle, every point on the circle is at the same distance, R. Yes? So every point will have the same magnitude of force. The direction will be different. Or let me go a step further. Let me have a point charge at the center and let me consider a ball around it, a sphere. Right? Now every charge, every point on the sphere will be at the same distance from the center, right? So what can I say? I can say if I move my unit charge along the surface of the sphere, the force will remain the same. Are you getting my point? Yes? So the force will remain the same. What will change? Only the direction of the force will change. If I take a point here, the force will be in this direction. If I take a point here, the force will be in this direction. If I take a point here, the force will be in this direction. So the direction will be different, but the magnitude will be the same. Okay? So this is used in defining a very important parameter. Let us see what it is. If we consider a charge Q1 fixed in space and move another charge QT, the test charge around it, there is a force acting on QT at all points. The force experienced by a unit test charge at any point is called the electric field intensity E at that point. I repeat, the electric field intensity E at any point is the force experienced by a unit positive charge at that point. Firstly, the electric field cannot exist unless you have a charge nearby. First, I need a charge, right? And around that charge, if I move the unit test charge, what is the force it would experience? So without the first charge, there is no question of an electric field. but I need not have the test charge. What can I say? I can specify the field at a point even without a test charge. I can say that is the force. Please listen carefully. That is the force a unit charge would experience at that point. So I have this charge, right? Okay. Now if I place a unit charge here, it would experience a force. So that force is what I call as the electric field intensity. I may place the unit test charge there or I may not place it there. But this charge I need, because without this charge, the test charge would not experience a force. Clear? So for the presence of an electric field, you need the presence of a charged particle, a charged surface, or a charged body, or a charged conductor. You need it. Okay? So E is equal to F by QT, that is Q1 by 4 pi epsilon naught R1 T squared, because T is my test charge, where I locate it, A1T. So now if you look at this, this formula is exactly similar to the Coulomb's force. So except that in the Coulomb's force, the second charge is equal to 1 Coulomb. So I just have Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R square Newton per Coulomb, because so many newtons per unit charge. And later on we will see this also is equal to volts per meter, because E will be the gradient of the potential V. So the unit of E can also be expressed as volts per meter, but I'll reserve this for later class, right? So now we got the concept of the electric field. So now remember, Coulomb's law obeys superposition. What does that mean? I have a number of charges, okay? And if I want a force on a charge, the force will be equal to the vector sum of the force due to all individual charges. Likewise, the electric field intensity also obeys superposition. That means if I have a number of charges, the electric field intensity at any point is equal to the vector sum of the field intensity due to each of the charges separately considered. So what should you know about the electric field E? It is a vector. It is a vector. Okay. Now, this is fine. So remember when we did spherical coordinates, I told you we have some symmetry. So instead of dealing with XYZ coordinates, supposing I think I have a point charge at the center of a sphere, right? Then at any point P, what is the direction of the field? It will be from the point charge to the point under consideration. So this is at the center. So I can say it is at a radial distance R, and it is in the radial direction, radial unit direction, right? So we can say that in spherical coordinates, I can simply say E is equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R squared AR, where Q is the charge which is producing the field E, right? And is located at the center of a sphere, and the point under consideration is at a radial distance R from the center of the sphere, and AR is the unit radial vector. Clear? So you see, due to a point charge, if I take a sphere, all points on the sphere are at the same radial distance. Therefore, all these points will have the same field intensity. I repeat, if you have a point charge, okay, all points at equidistant from this or on the equidistant sphere from the center, all these points will have the same electric field intensity, and everywhere the direction is, you know, radial, that is along the line joining the point charge on the surface. So it is easy to see that this field has a spherical symmetry. So I actually want you to visualize the field as some lines, you know, you can, I mean, it helps in visualization, though it is not actually like that. It helps in visualization. So if you have a point charge, just think of lines radiating from it, lines radiating everywhere. So each of the line gives you the line of the field intensity along that path. Okay, like this. So you can think of it as radiating. And now one more thing I want to draw your attention here. If you just see here, as R is small, the field intensity is very large. So as you move away from charge Q, what happens? The intensity goes on reducing. Ultimately, at R equal to infinity, the field becomes zero. That means at an infinite distance away from a point charge, you do not feel the effect of the charge. That's the meaning. The field intensity goes to zero. So now let us see another example. Two point charges, 50 microcoulomb and 10 microcoulomb, Q1 and Q2 are located at minus 1, 1, minus 3 and 3, 1, 0 meters. Find force on Q1. So now what I have Q1 and a Q2. I want the force on Q1. So Q1 is your destination point. Okay. So what should you do? Destination minus the source. Always remember, if you make a mistake in this point, then your vector is wrong. So you can't argue with the teacher and say, give me marks. The magnitude is correct. It is a vector quantity, and for any vector quantity, both the magnitude and the direction have to be correctly given. So destination minus the source. So let us see what it is. Minus 1 minus 3 is minus 4 ax. 1 minus 1 is 0. And minus 3 minus 0 is minus 3 az. Right? So this is a vector joining point 2 to 1. And the magnitude of this vector is root of 4 square plus 3 square, which is 5. Now F1 is equal to Q1 Q2 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught magnitude of R21 squared divided by AR21, right? So now what is AR21? It's a vector R21 divided by the magnitude. So very often this formula is also written as Q1 Q2 R vector divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R cubed. Right, because I have an R squared here and I'll have one more divided by R to get the unit vector, so I can together write it as 5 cubed. So you see here Q1, Q2, 4 pi epsilon naught, right? R squared will give me 5 squared, and to get the unit vector, I have minus 4 ax minus 3 az again divided by 5. So 5 squared into 5 becomes 5 cubed. So I have this. So that gives me 0.18 into minus 0.ax minus 0.6 az. So this is the unit vector and the magnitude is 0.18 newtons. These are all different ways of using the formula. Now, you might get problems like this. I have four charges, right, which are located along x and y axis. So it is two dimensional at plus or minus 4 meters, and find the force on a 100 microcoulomb charge at 003 meters. So what are the coordinates of these four charges? So it is located at plus or minus 4 x and plus or minus 4 y. So for x, plus or minus x, it is 400. And the other one is minus 400, and plus or minus 4y is 040 and 0 minus 40. So I have four charges of 20 microcoulombs located at these four points, right? So now the first thing I want to do is I want to evaluate the product Q1 Q2 by 4 pi epsilon naught is same because all the four charges are same. So what is going to change is your R, the vector distances. So first let us find out what are the vector distances. So from 1 to point P, from here to point, this is point P. So P is my destination. So it is 0 minus 4 minus 4 ax plus 3 az. right? Then from P to point 2, it is 0 minus of minus 4, that is plus 4ax. And from here to here, it is 0 and 3az. Next, P to point number 3. So this is 0, then this is minus 4ay plus 3az. And from P to point 4 is plus 4ay plus 3az. So what have I done now? I have got the vector distance between the four charges and the point under consideration. Clear? Now if you see, all of them have a magnitude of 5, root of 16 plus 9, which is 5. So all the four vectors have a magnitude of 5. It is only their directions which are different. So now you see here, F1 is Q1 Q2 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R1P by magnitude cubed. Similarly, F2 is Q1 Q2. I told you Q1 Q2 by 4 pi epsilon naught is common for all of them. Then the vector divided by 5 cubed. Now if I add these two, three, you see here these two have equal and opposite x components. So when I add these two, the x components will cancel, right? Similarly, F3 is same thing, Q1 Q2 by 4 pi epsilon naught. This is R3P divided by 5 cubed, and this is R4P divided by 5 cubed. 5 is the magnitude, remember. So now when I add these three, what happens? The y components will cancel. So when I add all the four, what happens? The x and y components cancel and I'm only left with z. And what z? 3az, 3az, 3 plus 3 plus 3 plus 3 divided by 5 cubed. So when I add all of them and do this arithmetic, I get F is 1.73az newtons. Clear? So what I want to draw your attention to here is the location of the points in space is very important to get the direction. See, the point, you may have all xyz coordinates in all the charges, but then when it comes to force, because the points, the charges themselves are not vectors, they are scalar quantities. But when it comes to force, since it's a vector, some components may cancel out each other and you have to be careful about that, keeping track of that. Fine. Next. Yeah, this is another problem. I have a point charge Q1 of 25 nanocoulombs and it is located at 4 minus 2, 7 at P1. And I have another charge Q2, 60 nanocoulombs at a point P2. First, find E at point P3 given by 1, 2, 3. Now I told you the E field, the electric field intensity, obeys superposition. Okay, so what is it? It is Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R squared. Again, it's in the radial direction, that is in the direction connecting the two charges. So here what do I have? I have a charge Q1, I have a charge Q2, right? And I have another point P3. So the field intensity at 3 would be due to this charge plus this charge, right? So 10 to the power of 9 is because of this nanocoulombs divided by 4 pi epsilon naught. This is 25 nanocoulombs R13, the vector joining 1 and 3, divided by R13 cubed. I told you this cube is because I have one more R13 for the unit vector. And 60, this is 60 nanocoulombs R23 divided by 23 cubed. Right? Now what is R13? So 3 is your destination and 1 is your source. So 1 minus 4, that is minus 3ax, and 2 minus of minus 2, that is plus 4ay, and 3 minus 7 is minus 4az. So this is R13. Next, R23. So 3 is 1 here. 1 minus of minus 3 is 4ax. 2 minus 4 is minus 2ay. And 3 minus of minus 2 is plus 5az. So now that you have established R13 and R23, Finding electric field intensity is simply application of this formula. Simple arithmetic. So R13 is root of 41, the magnitude. And the magnitude of R23 is root of 45. So E is given by 10 to the power of minus 9 by 4 pi epsilon naught, and this plus this, which works out to 4.58 AX minus 0.15 AY plus 5.15 AZ. Simple enough. Yes. So with point charges, it is easy to do. Now, sometimes you might get a slight twist in the way you are questioned. What is this? For the same problem, what I have taken, right? Now, I want you to find out a point on the y-axis where the Ex is zero. So what does it mean here? These two charges are the same. Q1 and Q2 are here, right? Now, I want you to locate a point P3. The point should lie on the y. I have two conditions on that. What are the two conditions? The first condition is it should lie on the y-axis, and the second condition is its x component should be zero, right? So now students often find such things very irritating and very tricky. Simple, apply logic. So first logic, since the point has to lie on the y-axis, its x and z coordinates have to be zero. So the point P3 is now specified, let us say, by zero, y zero. Y can be anything. It can lie anywhere on the y-axis. Now, my constraint is that at this point, particular point, the Ex component should be zero. Fine. So let us find out what happens. So now what does R13 become? So this point will become y plus 2 ay. And similarly, in R23, I have y minus 4 ay. Okay. So the formula for E is the same. This formula does not change. Okay, this formula is the same. Only thing is now R13 and R23 are different, right? This formula is the same. So I have established what is R12 and R13. They have the variables, they have the variable y, because I don't know what is the y coordinate. So I find out Ex, right? Ex is only the x component. So don't bother about this z. Find out what is the x component. So I have here minus 4. So I need this, and here the x component has a value magnitude of 3. So I have 25 plus minus 4 and 60 in, sorry, 25 into minus 4 and 60 into 3 divided by cube of this magnitude. So that is 65 plus y plus 2 whole squared, so on. I have not used any formula. I have not used any different formula, same as before. Only thing is I have taken only the x component. Don't bother about the y component, because my condition is to find where the x component is zero. Now you equate this to zero, right? So you will get a quadratic equation. You will get a quadratic equation, and simple. All this is simple arithmetic. Only this you have to do correctly. Only this is field theory. After this, it is simple arithmetic. So find out what is y. So solve for y, and I get minus 6.89 and minus 22.11. What is the meaning of this? This means that given the two charges, what we have, Q1 and Q2, then at point 0 minus 6.890 and at point 0 minus 22.110, at these two points, the electric field intensity will not have an x component. The x component is 0. That's what we are trying to do. Okay. So I have just tried to put different kinds of examples so that you know how the problems can be asked. Right. This is another example. Now let us consider one more example. I have 3-point charges, each of 5 nanocoulombs, and all are located on the x-axis at x equal to minus 1, x equal to 1, and x equal to 0 and 1. So at unit distances, minus 1, 0, and 1, I have 3 charges, right? I want you to find the field E at x equal to 5. So obviously, what happens? I have the 3 charges, all are in line. All are along the x-axis. Now I want you to find at one point along the x-axis. So obviously it will be in the x direction only. Only x component it will have. Now, supposing I take a general point x, let me take any point x on the x axis. What is the difference between x and minus 1? It will be x minus of minus 1, that is x plus 1. Are you understanding what I am saying? I have minus 1, then I have a point x. So the distance between these two will be x plus 1. And the distance between x and 0 will be x. And the difference between x and 1 will be x minus 1. So I have E is equal to q by 4 pi epsilon naught r squared, right? So the first distance is x plus 1 whole squared. The second distance is x, so I have 1 by x squared. And the third distance is x minus 1, so I have 1 by x minus 1 whole squared. And obviously it is along the x direction only. Okay, so this gives you the general expression for the field at any point x located on the x axis. So now, specifically at x equal to 5, I just substitute x equal to 5 here, right? I get E is equal to 5.8 ax volts per meter or newton per coulomb. Clear? Fine. Now, determine the value in the same question. So, I'm just telling you how to use some approximations. Determine the value and location of the equivalent single point charge that would produce the same field at very large distances. So, what does that mean? I have three charges, right? At minus 1, at 0 and 1. Okay. Now, supposing I consider at a large distance. Okay. So, just look at this formula. Supposing x was very large. Then the difference between what will be x plus 1 will be, let us say x is 1000. So the x plus 1 would be 1001, x square would be x would be 1000, and x minus 1 would be 999. So if you look at percentages, then it is negligible. Whereas supposing x was 1, then there would be a lot of difference. You know, this would be 2, this would be 1, and this would be 0. So there the percentage difference is very large. So as x increases, the difference between x plus 1 and x minus 1, as x is much greater than 1, reduces. So I can simply reduce this formula to 3 times 3q by 4 pi epsilon naught x squared. So what am I doing? I am saying approximately x plus 1, x and x minus 1 all are approximately equal to x, and therefore this formula becomes 3q by 4 pi epsilon naught x squared ax. So this is what happens, right? And therefore the equivalent charge would be 3q. I need to get 3q, and that would be 1.5 into 10 to the power of minus 8 coulombs, which is located at x equal to 0, to get the same field. Okay. Now, if I use this approximation to get the value of the field at x equal to 5, then it works out to be 5.4, whereas my actual value is 5.8. So, the error here is 7%. Now, as x becomes larger, this error will reduce. See, for x equal to 5 itself, the error is 7%. Supposing you take x is equal to 10, it would become negligible. So, why I put this example is, sometimes it is easy for you, if you make some approximations, to arrive at the field configurations. Now, we will do one example with cylindrical coordinates, so that we don't forget our coordinate systems. I have a 2 microcoulomb charge located at point 435 in free space. Find E rho, E phi and E z at point P 812 2. Okay, so I want you to find out the three components in the cylindrical coordinates at this point in space. So for such things, first it is easy, if it is easy, find E in Cartesian coordinates and then simply convert it into cylindrical or spherical coordinates. Fine. Now this point P is given by the rho is root of x squared plus y squared. This is I am converting this point P in Cartesian to cylindrical, and phi is tan inverse of y by x. It is in first quadrant since both are positive, and z is nothing but z, that is 2. Okay. And what is E? Q by 4 pi epsilon naught RAP. A is this, so it is 8 minus 4 ax 12 minus 3, 9ay, 2 minus 5, minus 3az divided by, the magnitude is root of 106, so root of 106 cubed is 106 to the power of 1.5, so this is my E. So I have here the vector field E in Cartesian coordinates. I simply convert it into cylindrical coordinate. How do we convert from Cartesian to cylindrical? Take the dot product with respect to the unit vectors in cylindrical coordinates. So I have EP dot A rho. So again we get the same exercise. AX dot A rho, AY dot A rho, AZ dot A rho is anyway 0, right? And this is nothing but cos phi. AX dot A rho is cos phi and AY dot A rho is sin phi. So using this I get 159.7, and E phi is EP dot A rho. So I get AX dot A rho, AY dot A rho, I get this. So I get 27.4 and EZ remains the same. So in Cartesian, from Cartesian coordinate, in cylindrical coordinates, the field at this point is given by 159.7 A rho plus 27.4 A phi minus 49.4 AZ. So that's how we calculate the E field. Now, this is another similar problem. So here I have 100 nanocoulombs located at point minus 113 in free space. Now, I'm just trying to put different kinds of problems. Okay, these are all from HAIT. So you have to know how in different ways they are used. So find the locus of all the points of P, X, Y, Z where EX is equal to 500 volts per meter. So I want the magnitude of the X component to be equal to 500 volts. So now what is EP? Q by 4 pi epsilon naught RAP by RAP, magnitude of RAP cubed. This is at any point. Now what is my constraint on P? P is a point X, Y, Z. Okay. And so what will be RAP? X minus of minus 1, that is X plus 1, Y minus 1 and Z minus 3. So this is my vector joining the point A to any arbitrary point X, Y, Z. So this is the magnitude. The magnitude of this is X plus 1 whole squared plus Y minus 1 whole squared plus Z minus 3 whole squared under root. Right? Now I want only the X component. Okay, so what will be the X component? Take the X part of it. So it will be X plus 1 divided by the magnitude cubed, RAP cubed, right? RAP is this under root. So cubed will be to the power of 3 by 2 or 1.5. So I get this, and this, my constraint is that this should be equal to 500 volts per meter. That's all. So you do a little bit of arithmetic manipulation and you get the equation in a neat form. So the equation I get is X plus 1 is equal to something 0.56 into X plus 1 whole squared plus Y minus 1 whole squared plus Z minus 3 whole squared to the power of 3 by 2. So any point X, Y, Z which satisfies this equation lies on the locus where EX is equal to 500 volts per meter. Now again I want you to draw attention to this point. EX is the X component of the field intensity E. However, it depends on all the three coordinates X, Y and Z. The main misconception students make is in presuming that the X component is determined only by the X coordinate and Y. No. Again and again I'm telling, each of the components are functions of all the three coordinates. Look at this. Here I have X component is 500, but I have Y, Z, X, everything here, right? And now I have given you, find if a continuation of this, I have given a point minus 2, Y, 1, 3, whether it lies on the locus. Okay, so you put for what points it lies on the locus. So here X is minus 2 and Z is 3. So you just substitute for X and Z and you'll get an equation in Y, right? And solving for that, you get two points, 1.69 and 0.31. So these two points lie of Y lie on the locus. Okay, that means at these two points, that is minus 2, x is minus 2 and y is either 1.69 or 0.31 and z is 3. This gives you 2 points. At these 2 points, the magnitude of the x component of the E field, E vector is 500 volts per meter. So I will end today's session with this problem. This is again interesting, very common. I have two charges, Q1 and Q2. My first advice to all the students is, in any problem in field theory, first draw the configuration. The moment you draw it, lot of things will be clear. In which direction the field goes, where are the points, how are they spaced, which is close, which is farther, everything will come. So the first thing is draw the picture. So here I have two equal charges are located at the ends of a line of D meters. This is the question. Find the field E at a point H meters on the perpendicular bisector. Right? So fine. First let me draw a line, right, of length D. So the center I will say is at the origin. I can keep it anywhere. For simplicity, I'll keep it at the origin. So I have D by 2 on one side and D by 2 on the other side. I have Q1 and Q2 equal charges. Now I want the field at any point on the perpendicular bisector, which lies at H meters above. Okay. So for simplicity, let's assume this is the X axis and this is the Y axis. Okay. So what is the coordinate of point P? I told you this is the origin, so P will be 0h, right? And this lies along the x axis, so Q1 will lie at minus d by 2, x is minus d by 2 and y is 0. I'm assuming it lies on the x axis. All these are perfectly all right. Your answer will not be wrong or different, right? I'm assuming the charges lie along the x axis, so my perpendicular bisector is the y axis, that's all. And Q2 will be at d by 2 and 0. So what will be R1? R1 will be the difference of these two. So it will be D by 2 AX plus H AY. And R2 would be minus D by 2 AX plus H AY. Okay. And E1 is Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R by magnitude of R whole cubed. And E2 is again Q by 4 pi epsilon naught R2 by magnitude of R2 whole cubed. So now if you see here, the X components will cancel and you have only the Y component, 2QH divided by 4 pi epsilon naught, to get this. Now I want you again, without deriving, by just looking at this, you should be able to figure it out. See, what is the direction of the field due to this charge at this point? It will be in this direction, right? And the field due to this will be in this direction. Okay. So if you split this vector into two components, you have along the x axis and along the y axis. And this vector, if you split into two components, you have along the minus ax axis and the y axis. Since these two charges are equal, the x components will cancel and you will have 2 times the y component. So sometimes by looking at the charge configurations, you must quickly deduce in which direction the field will be. So here, the conclusion here is, whenever you have two charges, right, the field at the perpendicular bisector is directed along the perpendicular bisector itself, if the two charges are equal. Repeat, if the two charges are equal, then the field along the perpendicular bisector will lie on the perpendicular, along the direction of the perpendicular bisector itself. So if I have a field in, let us say I have a charge, two charges in this direction, and I want a field here, the field is oriented like this, if provided the two are equal. And if the charge, let us say, is like this, and along the perpendicular direction, the field will be oriented like this. So it is very simple, it is oriented along that itself. Now as an opening for tomorrow's class, I ask you to go back and just ponder for a moment, what will happen if Q1 and Q2 are of opposite signs but equal? That means the magnitude of E they produce will be same, but it will be in opposite directions. So tomorrow I want an answer from you people, or you should be able to understand when I take off. Thank you.